Hachette Audio presents Blood of Assassins, The Wounded Kingdom, Book 2. Written by R.J. Barker. Read by Joe Jameson.
Chapter 1. A ground mist was rising. The sun brushed the dew-soaked grass, and after days walking through the stink and dirt of the eastern Sourlands, the riotous excitement of year's birth made me drunk on the scent of early morning blossom. Far over the horizon, the birth storm swelled, towering pillows of dark cloud that heralded the giant storm which told us year's birth was truly here. It felt like a weight on my back. The mercenaries came upon us in that moment when the world seemed unreal, poised between outgoing night and incoming day. Six attacked, four men and two women of the Glintai, a hard and relentless people from the arid mountains far across the taut sea, where water was as valuable as bread, and those who could not prove their worth were killed out of hand. If our attackers had been men of Maniyadoc, they would have come for me first, seeing a man in armour as more of a danger than a woman. But they were not. The Glintai tribes kept to the old ways, and besides, if they hunted us, they knew who we were. They knew my master was the real danger. Four went for her, two for me. They had roarers, long sticks that sent out shards of sharp metal in a cough of smoke and fire. As weapons, they are as ugly and as poor at killing as most Glintai. One exploded, killing its bearer and wounding the woman with him. The other made a horrendous noise and shredded a small bush by my side. My master and I were tired. We fought in silence. The Glintai are fierce, but rely on numbers and savagery. I had spent 5 years as a mercenary, stood in shield walls, facing down charging mounts, and wasn't scared of a few men and women in animal skins, no matter how hard they fought.
"I'll skin you alive, boy,"
hissed the huge Glintai, the first to approach me. His long beard was dyed with a blue stripe, and his blonde hair was tied in braids which snaked out from underneath a rusted helmet. In one hand he held a heavy sword, and in the other he twirled a skinning knife, laughing all the while.
"I'll carve the skin from your bones, child," he said,
his mouth an unkempt wall of missing teeth. I have lain back in silence while my master carves magical glyphs which twitch and move of their own accord into my flesh. I am not afraid of pain. "In truth, I've never been comfortable in this skin." I smiled at him, and for a moment he was confused, but only a moment. He fainted with his knife. I ignored it. Then he brought his sword over and let its weight bring it down on me. I angled my large shield, taken in single combat from a Liridian champion, and painted with a bleeding eye, and his blade slid away on it and bit into the earth as I brought the beaked warhammer, taken from a man I had killed in vengeance, round in a swing which punched a neat hole in his helmet and felled him. I glanced over at my master. She fought with two stab swords, dancing lively in and out of the flashing blades of her attackers, as if they did not exist. For a moment her skill stole my breath away, and then the second Glintai was on me. This one was far more careful and held a long spear, a better weapon against an armoured man with a shield, but like his fellow, he was too used to ferocity winning his battles. His only skill lay in attack, and he lacked the warrior's greatest ally. Patience. He came in, jabbing his spear against my shield with a teeth-grating screech of metal on metal. As he jabbed again, I put all my strength into a forward push of the shield. I felt the strength of his blow in the jarring of my shoulder joint. He felt it in his hands, and though he did not drop the spear, his control of it lapsed for long enough to let me in close. The warhammer rose and fell, rose and fell, rose and fell, until his head was a pulpy mush of grey brains, white bone, and bright red blood.
"Girton,"
my master's soft voice behind me.
"They are done."
Blood dripped from a cut on her arm. It ran down her hand, along the hilt of her stab sword, to mingle with the Glintai blood that stained her blade. It was only when she spoke that I heard myself, heard the noise that I was making, the screaming of an animal. I dropped my weapon in the mud. The warhammer was heavy.
"One still lives,"
I said, and pointed at the woman who had been felled when the roar exploded. I walked towards her, unsheathing the black metal stab sword I kept on my left hip.
Wait, Girton.
Why? I continued towards the woman. She was burned down one side, but had no killing wounds. She will only tell others where we are.
Wait.
My master jumped over a corpse and ran to me, grabbing my arm just as I was about to kneel down and slit the wounded woman's throat.
There are better ways.
I stared at my master, the muscles of my arm tight against her grip. So you say. I brushed her hand from my arm and sat back on bloodied grass. The burned woman watched all this with eyes as bright as those of the blackbirds of Zeus, the unseen, god of death.
Your lover is fierce, even though he's mage-bent, Merilacan,
croaked the woman to my master. If she had ever had beauty for the burns to spoil, it had long since fled.
He is not my lover, said my master.
Are you one who prefers women, then? He is young, strong.
Quiet!
My master grabbed the woman's face with her hand, breaking the burned skin around her mouth and leaving a raw fingerprint that had the woman hissing in pain.
What tribe are you?
The glint-eye woman had eyes like a hunting lizard, as blue as the sky they dived from and full of the same scorn for life.
Gershtai,
she said, the name of her tribe distorted by my master's hold on her face and the pain of her burns.
And your name?
Als.
Well, Als of the Gershtai, listen to me. I am Merilla Khan, and my companion is Girton Club-Foot. We have killed many Glint-eye as we travelled back to Maniyadoc. 17 of the Chorist, 12 of the Jainil, and 14 of the Justu. By my reckoning, that means if you head back to your mountains, the Gershtai will outnumber the other tribes. Take this information to your leader, conquer new lands, and send no more of your young to die in search of the price on our heads.
The glint-eye woman stared at my master. Before she replied, we were interrupted by a grunt from behind us. I turned. The first man I had hit with the hammer was convulsing.
My man, said the tribeswoman. He fought well. Let your boy give him a good death, and I will consider what you say.
I looked to my master and she gave me a nod. So I walked over and slit the man's throat with my black blade. By the time I returned, the glint-eye woman was on her feet.
I will give your message to our clan woman.
My master told you to stop sending people after us. Angry steps towards her, blade in my hand, but my master held me back once more.
Thank you, Als of the Gershtai, she said. Leave here and die well.
The woman staggered away into the ground mist, turning at that moment when wisps of thickened air made her look like a ghost.
I will die well, she said. But you won't, Merilla Khan. No, you won't. You will die hard.
The moist air swallowed her figure, leaving only laughter behind. She did not promise to leave us alone, I said. You should have made her promise to leave us alone or killed her.
One more glint-eye won't make a difference in the great scheme of things, Girton. But if I can convince them to start a tribal war, they'll be too busy killing each other to come after us. The Gershtai are the biggest tribe and...
Her voice tailed away, and when I turned to her, she looked stricken. Her dark skin grey with shock.
Gershtai, she said, and stared at the cot on her arm. Dark Ungar's stolen breath, she hissed. The Gershti are poisonous.
As she spoke, she was pulling the rawhide cord from the neck of her jerkin and wrapping it around the top of her arm.
Girton, start a fire, hot as you can get it, quickly.
Yes, master. A cold fell upon me, far deeper than could be explained by the year's birth morning chill, and it froze the simmering resentment that had been my companion for the years of our exile. I was running almost before I was aware of it. Wood is sparse in the Tired Lands, especially so near the border of the Sourlands, but I found a derelict haystack, sodden with dew on the outside, and I burrowed within to pull dry grass from it. Beyond the haystack was a field where cows had been kept, and dry circles of dung punctuated the grass.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.